Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to the third Department of Medicine Grand Rounds on COVID-19 updates, and welcome you and thank you for joining in bright and early this morning. I get to be your MC today, I think, because I'm the most technologically challenged of the speakers, but we do have a fabulous lineup for you today, covering a variety of different topics. Doesn't seem to be advancing. Okay, as just to confirm that I am technologically having a problem. So as I said, we have a fabulous lineup today that's going to cover a wide range of different topics, from disparities, venothromboembolism, kidney, which may be my personal favorite, heart issues, and COVID-19 and community pandemic projections. Just a couple of housekeeping things for today. You will be muted during the whole presentation, but if you have a question during the presentation, you can either ask your question on Microsoft Teams using the chat box, or you can email your questions to Tam or to Linda directly to their email. The recording will be available at about one day, business day, after today's Department of Medicine Grand Rounds. At the end of the speaking, after Dr. Ko finishes, we will have time, hopefully, to address your questions. Also, there is CME available for today's Department of Medicine Grand Rounds, and you can either text it as you do normally when we're in person, or you can email. And if you have any questions about obtaining your CME, lots of information on the screen. So I'm going to hand it over now to Dr. Khalilah Gates.
Alrighty, good morning. So today I'm going to talk about the healthcare disparities and the impact of those on the COVID-19 pandemic, as we know that that's kind of been in the news recently. So a couple things we're going to do in the next 5 minutes or so. We're going to look at the data. We're going to look at US data as well as look at Illinois and Chicago. We'll evaluate some of the underlying factors that are contributing to the disparities that we're seeing, and then we'll take a little bit of a glance at our current data. Alrighty, so as we have all heard in the media, we have significant disparities in the African-American community as COVID is impacting these patients. So in Louisiana, the African-American community makes up about 70% of the deaths in the COVID group, but that community only accounts for 33% of the total Louisiana population. So clearly there's some disparities there. And as you can see from this graph, this was in the Washington Post, it's data from Johns Hopkins, you can see quite a few states that are looking at this data are showing the similar trends. And we're basically seeing on the left, the percentage that the African-American population makes up for that state. And then on the right, you're seeing the percentage of deaths from COVID. And you can see in Michigan, in Milwaukee, Louisiana, DC, and Chicago, as well as Illinois as a whole, that there are some disparities that despite the lower population, you are having increased death in COVID disease. And so the question is, why is that happening? For us, in Illinois, African-Americans make up about 15% of the population, but we're experiencing about 40% of the COVID deaths. And so the question is, what is driving this disparity? So a very common model of healthcare disparities. So let's just start off with the definition so that we're all having the same working definition. And we can think of this health disparities as a particular type of health difference that is closely linked to social and or economic disadvantage. And we'll come back to that because it's important to recognize the social aspects of this. And we believe that that's actually what's driving this the most. And so in this very commonly used description of healthcare disparities, on the y-axis, you have quality of care. And then you look at the difference between non-minority and minority groups, and you see this gap, and that is the healthcare disparity. And the question is, what is causing, or what are the factors that are driving that gap? And multiple studies over the years have shown that that gap is caused by access to care issues, quality of care issues, operation of healthcare systems, and legal and regulatory climate, so systematic structural problems that exist, as well as discrimination that includes bias, and this is where the implicit bias comes in, stereotyping and uncertainty. And it is those things that we need to look at, particularly in this current pandemic, and try to address so that we can close that disparate gap. So when we think of the disparities, we often talk about African-American, Latino minorities, and that is a description of race. And what I want us to think about is that race is really serving as a proxy for other things, okay? And so when we say race, and when we say Black, and we say African-American, we know that through the human genome studies, there's not a whole lot of genetic variation between races. We know that. And so what actually is driving this difference? And so it's believed that the social aspects of this healthcare system are actually what's driving it. And we use race to identify things like socioeconomic status, like education, like living factors. And so what you'll see on your left is a WHO framework of social health, social determinants of health. So what are the social aspects that go into determining outcomes of health? And what you'll see in the column here is that socioeconomic position, your social class, your gender and ethnicity, education, occupation, and income are pretty significant determinants of health that will impact that. And so in the US healthcare system, when we say Black, when we say Latino, we are essentially using those terms to discuss that category. And so what we're essentially saying is low SES, lower education, certain populations of occupation, and lower income. And those are the things that we need to keep in mind as we're talking about these disparities, because those are the things that we're going to be able to tackle to try to decrease this gap. So when you think about this, and when we say Black, in this case African-American, what we're really talking about and what we really need to think about is we're talking about a group of essential workers. We're talking about the bus drivers. We're talking about the grocery store workers, people who can't stay at home, people who can't social distance, people who typically have higher household contacts. And so if they do become positive, it's more difficult for them to isolate themselves. And so those are truly the factors that we're dealing with as we're talking about COVID-19 and how to deal with it. And we're dealing with the group of people, patients, who are not able for multiple reasons to do what we're recommending. And so we have to tackle the system that is preventing that. Just a look at Chicago. So you can actually go on the IDPH website and you can put in various zip codes and you can figure out the cases. And so I just looked at a map of where we have the highest cases of COVID, and I took a look at income, percent African-American in the cases there. And what you can see, and we'll use Streeterville where we work as the main comparison, we have a population with a high median income of about $86,000. We have a low African-American population, and we only have 33 positive COVID cases, and those are in whites. If you look at a traditionally underserved population like Chatham, which is 97% African-American with a medium income of $35,000, so half of what Streeterville is, you see in that same community with similar numbers, 257 COVID positive cases. So not only are these patients dying from COVID, but they also have more cases they have more cases, and that is tending to align with income, so socioeconomic status, and not simply just race. Okay, and so we'll end here with our COVID data that we have so far. And this is thanks to Dr. Wunderink and Dr. Rafeman, who helped me with this. So if we look at our ICU up to yesterday, we have 40% of our ICU cases being African-American, and that's about 46 patients, with 35% or 40 patients being white, and then the others either Asian or not determined. If we look at the floor patients, we still have a majority 47% African-American with 30% white. The mortality rate here at Northwestern does not align with the mortality rate that we're seeing, thankfully. We actually have improved mortality based on our numbers in the ICU as well as on the floor in African-Americans. I think the factors that are going to explain that we have yet to explore, but that is some reassuring data, at least for Northwestern. Okay. And so with that, I'll just end with saying that the COVID-19 pandemic, it's not the virus itself that is impacting the African-American community. It is the virus that has unmasked persistent health disparities that we've not dealt with up until now. Back in 1985, Margaret Heckler, the Secretary of Health at that time, put out the Heckler Report, which in 1985 stated that there were huge healthcare disparities in American healthcare system that we needed to address. And in 2020, we're still saying there are persistent healthcare disparities that we need to address. And so COVID is telling us as a community that it is now time to deal with what we know. We are quick to say that chronic disease, diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, those are the reasons that these patients are not doing as well. What I'm suggesting to you is that this community has higher levels of obesity, diabetes, and coronary artery disease because of the health disparities. And so if we can tackle health disparities, we can tackle some of the other ailments of these communities. And then as a medical community, it's now time to systematically and strategically address health disparities. And so what I want to end with is just something that I wrote as an African-American woman in Chicago with a family who's plagued by diabetes, hypertension. This whole COVID thing had me really thinking, and so I put my thoughts on paper. And kind of what I concluded is that we cannot walk out of this the same as we walked into it. We must be willing to admit that this current system is failing the most vulnerable, that we as a collective group have much more work to do individually and professionally to decrease the healthcare disparities gap. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Khalilah. And I hope that something that good comes out of this COVID pandemic is we're able to address those problems a little bit better. So I'm Mike Cuttica. I'm one of the pulmonary critical care docs, and I was asked to talk about COVID-19 and venous thromboembolism. I have no disclosures for this talk. So talking about venous thromboembolism in the setting of the COVID-19 pandemic is kind of a difficult topic because there's not a lot of data out there to base this talk on. We start with two of the papers that or early publications that came out of China that looked at or recognized D-dimer as a marker of prognosis that sort of sparked this question and interest in whether or not clotting is an issue that we're seeing in patients with COVID infection. So on the left is one of the very first case reports that came out of China by Huang et al. That looked at 41 cases from Wuhan. And this was the original paper that identified D-dimer as a marker of severity of disease. Excuse me. Not only as being elevated in patients with COVID infection, but being more elevated in patients that required ICU level care. And then on the right, a publication that came out a little bit later from the same area in China of 191 patients where they were able to do a multivariate regression analysis that showed that elevated D-dimer along with age and SOFA score, a marker of organ system dysfunction, but a D-dimer greater than one was associated with an increased odds of death in patients with COVID-19 infection. So this kind of sparked, I think, the beginning interest in whether or not the D-dimer was a marker of clotting abnormalities like venous thromboembolism or pulmonary embolism as a driver of the mortality. But as we know, D-dimer is not specific to PE or DVT. D-dimer has been shown to be elevated in patients with critical illness, sepsis, independent of clotting, and is oftentimes a acute phase reactant that just is a sign of critical illness. But because of this initial report, there has been interest in looking into the role of venous thromboembolism and pulmonary embolism in these patients. So I'm going to highlight just a couple of the case series that have come out trying to address this question of whether or not this is something we should be looking at, especially since D-dimers is so important. And like I said before, the data is not great in this area, but it raises some interesting questions. So this is a case report that again came out of China, just published this month, where they looked at 1,000 hospitalized patients with COVID infection, and then retrospectively went back and said how many of these patients had CT scans looking for pulmonary embolism, so a CT pulmonary angiogram. And they found that of the 1,000 patients in hospitalized for this, 25 patients had CTPAs done for suspected PE. So this was a clinical indication to say we wanted to look for pulmonary embolism. So of that 2% of those 1,000 hospitalized patients that had PE study done, only 10 were diagnosed with acute pulmonary embolism. And the CT scan was done on day 10 of the hospitalization. It was unclear from this report whether or not any of these patients were on DVT prophylaxis in the hospital. So they had been hospitalized for about 10 days and then had their PE study done. And then in the of those 25 patients that had CT scans and only 10 that had documented PE, 20 of the patients were then treated with low molecular weight heparin after the PE diagnosis. And they showed in these patients a downtrend in the D-dimer, and of the three of these patients had repeat CT scans that showed decreased clot burden. So a small percentage of patients that were actually diagnosed with PE out of the patients that ended up having a PE protocol CT scan done. And then what they tried to show on this in the bottom chart there is they again looked at the D-dimer and found that of the patients that they followed here, the 25 that that had CT scans, all of those patients had an elevated D-dimer level, but they were able to show that of the 10 that had a PE positive study, PE on their CT angiogram, their D-dimer seemed to be more elevated than those with the negative PE study. So then looking at the risk of thrombosis, based on that, then there was two other publications that we looked at that shows perhaps an increased risk of thrombosis in patients with COVID-19 infection. Again, out of China, this is a publication, a retrospective look at 81 patients, all admitted to the intensive care unit. Again, in this publication, they said none of them were on DVT prophylaxis, and retrospectively looked at ultrasound of the leg for the diagnosis of deep vein thrombosis. And what they found in this group of patients hospitalized in the intensive care unit, not on DVT prophylaxis, was that 20 of the 81 patients, or 25% of the population, were diagnosed with DVT. And they, in this paper, suggested that a D-dimer elevated above 1.5 on their assay was predictive of DVT. So again, not sure if that really correlates with an increased risk of thrombosis if we see our patients in the intensive care unit hospitalized in bed not on DVT prophylaxis. We would expect to have a high rate of DVT diagnosed in those patients. And then this is a patient out of a study out of the Netherlands that again retrospectively looked at 184 patients with COVID-19 infection in the intensive care unit. All of these patients were on DVT prophylaxis. And what they found in this study was that over the course of the month and a half that they followed these patients before they censored the data, the dose of their DVT prophylaxis seemed to increase as the clinical experience with COVID-19 infection was gathered. The testing that was done to look for clot was done based on clinical suspicion at the discretion of the physician. And what they found over time was that the cumulative incidence of venous and arterial clotting was quite elevated at 31%. That was the cumulative incidence. And what they showed here in this graph was that it seems like they plateaued at about 10 days to 2 weeks. The cumulative incidence of venous thromboembolism or arterial clotting seemed to plateau at about day 10 to day 15. Although you have to be careful interpreting this, because when they censored the data, they still had a high percentage of patients that were still in the intensive care unit, receiving care. So it may be that we just weren't, they did not identify later stage clotting in these patients. And when they looked at what type of clotting events they had, 25 patients had pulmonary embolism. 7 of those were subsegmental, 18 were segmental clot. 3 had DVT, and the rest had evidence of arterial thrombosis with ischemic strokes. So again, I think the cumulative sort of data from all of these studies, I think, suggests to us that maybe there's an increased risk of thrombosis in this patient population. And then this is one final study that looked out of China that looked at treatment with heparin in COVID-19 patients. Although, interestingly, these are patients that were actually just treated with DVT prophylaxis dosing low molecular weight heparin. So again, a retrospective review in the same hospital as the DVT paper, looking at 449 patients with severe COVID infection in the ICU. 99% of these patients ended up receiving 7 days or longer of low molecular weight heparin at prophylactic dosing. There were no bleeding complications reported, as we'd expect, since we don't really see much bleeding from DVT prophylaxis dosing in the ICU. And what they showed here was no difference in 28-day mortality in the cohort as a whole. So it couldn't document in these 400 or so patients, 100 of which were receiving DVT prophylaxis, that putting them on the low molecular weight heparin affected their mortality. But when they did subgroup analysis of patients with a sepsis-induced coagulopathy score of greater than 4, so a high score, high risk of clotting, heparin was associated with a reduced mortality. And again, in that subset of patients that had very elevated D-dimer, the treatment with prophylactic dosing, low molecular weight heparin, was also associated with reduced mortality. So in our experience here at Northwestern, again, we basically are seeing mainly single organ system failure with an ARDS-like injury to the lung, where we see patients that have pretty normal lung compliance. They're defined as having pretty severe hypoxemia that is responsive to high PEEP and prone positioning. Airway clearance is a major issue, which is improving now as we are getting back to using more and more of our standard airway clearance techniques, but they have very thick sort of milky secretions that lead to mucus plugging, recurrent mucus plugging. And we've even we've been engaged in a low tidal volume strategy with high PEEP, low FiO2 as our way of managing these people through their COVID infection. So again, that's the major issue that we're seeing, is single organ system failure. I don't have the hard data from our population yet, but we have anecdotally, through report of the people taking care of these patients in the ICU, seen what seems like an increased risk of thrombotic complications. Interestingly, when you talk to the nurse practitioner staff and the resident staff of the hospital, we're seeing an increased incidence of arterial thrombosis, so clotting off arterial lines, needing replacement of the arterial lines. We've had a couple patients with dialysis needing anticoagulation for clotting off the circuits over and over again, and there has been subjectively noted increased risk of DVT and PE. Although it's been an interesting presentation, I got called by one of our fellows yesterday as I was finishing up my slides, saying we had a patient, a young man who had been in the intensive care unit 2 weeks prior, who had had an elevated D-dimer at the time that he was in. He survived. He got extubated after multiple proning sessions, was out and on the floor for a little over a week, almost 2 weeks, and pulmonary got consulted for tachycardia. and nocturnal hypoxemia. They thought, oh, maybe this is just obstructive sleep apnea, and ended up having a large burden pulmonary embolism on the PE scan. So not knowing, was that a clot that had been there for the last 2 weeks, or was that something that developed on the floor? I think we're seeing sort of odd presentations here. So this is one of the guidelines that was put out by the International Society on Thrombosis and Hemostasis, an interim guideline. And you can see here, you know, they highlight a couple things. They again highlight the importance of D-dimer as a marker of illness. And in patients with markedly elevated D-dimer, they are actually recommending admission for, you know, just having the D-dimer for elevated for observation. And then in those without markedly elevated D-dimer, potentially admission or following, but from a coagulation standpoint, the recommendation really is just prophylactic dosing of low molecular weight heparin. There is not a recommendation for full dose anticoagulation in these patients, even in ones who have markedly elevated D-dimers. And this is consistent with the American Hematologic Society recommendations as well. So just to conclude, I think there is growing evidence on increased thrombosis risk in patients with COVID-19 infection. The case reports that are coming out, our experience would suggest that these patients perhaps are at increased risk for infection. Biomarkers like D-dimer are difficult to interpret in the setting of critical illness, right? Are these being elevated just because of critical illness, or is this really telling us about clotting risk in these patients? And I think that also raises the question of, is this really unique to COVID-19, or would, you know, do we see this in all critically ill patients, but we just don't trend D-dimer in patients that have run-of-the-mill ARDS or run-of-the-mill sepsis? There's really a limitation here that we run into on testing due to isolation needs in the diagnosis of VT. So we're not sending patients down for PE protocol CT scans the way we might in a normal ICU when patients are presenting with high D-dimer. So we may not be diagnosing or recognizing it quite as much. The consistent recommendations for DV, specialty groups, there's a consistent recommendation, as always, that these patients should be on standard DVT prophylaxis in all COVID-19 patients. But diagnostic testing and full dose anticoagulation decisions really need to be made on a case-by-case basis based on clinical presentation. Thank you.
Okay, good morning. I'm going to talk a little bit about kidney issues and COVID-19. I have no disclosures for today's talk. I do want to start out with a big shout out to incredible division and trainees who provided tremendous leadership during this time so that we've overhauled the way we practice both outpatient and inpatient to ensure our patients are receiving exceptional care during this very difficult time. So with respect to acute kidney injury and COVID-19, again, we do not have precise data yet, but coming out of the largest cohort studies from China, the estimates are that approximately 5% of all hospitalized patients with COVID-19 will develop acute kidney injury. And this number increases in critically ill patients, ranging from 25 to 29% of patients. Importantly, when we think about patients with acute kidney injury who require dialysis or renal replacement therapy, the estimates, again, from the published studies and also from our colleagues in New York City, is around 15 to 20%, and that aligns with what we're seeing here at Northwestern, with approximately 20% of critically ill COVID-19 patients requiring dialysis. A question, does acute kidney injury increase the mortality from COVID-19? And similar to all critically ill patients in the ICU who develop acute kidney injury, the answer is very likely yes, although again, we don't have precise numbers. A very talented assistant professor in the division, Anand Srivastava, is the site PI for a very large trial, Stop COVID. It's 40 sites, more than 2,000 patients, more than 1 million data entry points. The data entry will end tonight at midnight, I believe, with a publication planned for the next month, looking at the risk factors and outcomes for mortality, but also for acute kidney injury and end-stage kidney disease in COVID-19 patients. Anand is leading it here in collaboration with Rich. So we're looking forward to those to that information. What's causing the acute kidney injury in these patients? Well, again, similar to many other critically ill patients who develop ARDS, acute tubular necrosis, due to multi-organ failure and shock, cytokine storm, hyperinflammatory syndrome. And similar to the SARS outbreak we saw in 2003, there is an incidence of rhabdomyolysis resulting in acute kidney injury in some patients. Something a little bit different with the acute kidney injury in these patients, there has been reported higher incidence of proteinuria and hematuria, suggesting potentially glomerular involvement, as well as some reports of massive albuminuria. We don't have much good data on what's really going on in the kidney. There have been very limited autopsy studies and only one unreported biopsy that I'm aware of. From 32 postmortem patients studied in two studies, not surprisingly, severe acute tubular necrosis was seen in the majority. Vacuolization, severe vacuolization of tubules consistent with rhabdomyolysis in some. There's evidence of some complement deposition on tubules, suggesting maybe complement activation that may play into some of the hypercoagulability and vascular injury, although not profound thrombosis or full-blown thrombotic microangiopathy, but some severe vascular injury. In the one biopsy from New Orleans, a patient who presented and developed 15 grams of proteinuria about 5 days into the treatment was biopsied and had an unusual form of collapsing focal segmental glomerular sclerosis. And what was interesting in the autopsy studies is viral particles were observed in all the patients in proximal tubule cells, typical of the coronavirus, and in podocytes, which are those cells in the glomerulus, suggesting that yes, there might be some glomerular injury. And I think we all know now that this virus enters cells through the ACE2 protein and some co-receptors expressed on epithelial cells in the lung, but also very highly expressed by proximal tubule epithelial cells and to a lesser extent in podocytes. And this is reminiscent of another viral disease where we know that HIV-associated nephropathy, HIV virus sits in a reservoir in the podocytes, and that's associated with a collapsing variant of FSGS. So again, not nearly enough data to make any conclusions, but something that nephrologists are keeping an eye on. So how are we managing these patients? Well, it's largely supportive. We have to be conservative with fluid management because of the risk of respiratory compromise, and all forms of renal replacement are on the table, depending on the hemodynamic stability of the patient. And at the bottom, you'll see acute peritoneal dialysis. And this, yes, is potentially indicated for acute kidney injury. It's something we used to do in the old days when I was a resident, and it's still done in the third world. But this has been used both in Seattle as well as in New York City, where resources for dialysis have become very limited. And this is acute PD catheter insertion at the bedside and frequent exchanges. So even though we're very interested in the pathophysiology of what's going on, what we have focused on as a division and as a team over the past month has really been planning for how to manage the resources. As Mike was mentioning, there's certainly been a lot of discussion across the country as well as globally about the clotting of dialysis circuits. Staffing is a real issue. We have highly specialized nurses who are doing treatments, many of whom might require quarantine. Supplies have been an issue with dialysate tubing, even having the right number of rooms, having the appropriate plumbing for dialysis in the floors of the hospital. To give you an example, my colleague at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City, who's the chair of the Department of Medicine, the ventilators are not a limiting factor right now. It's the dialysis machines and the staffing. The way that we've dealt with it here, as Mike was talking about, the anticoagulation in the critically ill patients, and in fact, we've not had much of an issue. We've had good success with citrate anticoagulation, reducing exposure for our nurses, coming up with some creative solutions, some of which are possible here, some of which are not, with remote monitoring, but ensuring that they have appropriate PPE. So for bedside non-intubated patients who are coughing, where our nurses have to sit bedside for up to 4 hours, having the ability to wear PAPRs is to protect this very valuable resource. For surge planning, over a month ago, we already brought in extra portable dialysis machines. We can alter prescriptions. So instead of having 24-hour continuous renal replacement therapy, prolonged intermittent renal replacement therapy, so we can dialyze two or three patients on the same machine. Having acute PD, I already mentioned, and our surgical colleagues, Dr. Davila and Dr. DeFranzo, are ready to go to insert these bedside catheters if we need. And IT has been fabulous in developing a dashboard for us so that we can predict which patients might be impending need for dialysis in the hospital and what our resources and staffing backup are. I want to move away from acute kidney injury for the last couple of minutes and talk about another very vulnerable at-risk population during COVID-19. This was an op-ed in the New York Times this past weekend. You can imagine that our hemodialysis patients who must visit a dialysis center three times a week where social distancing is not an option. These patients also have a number of comorbidities that put them at risk, and certainly underrepresented minorities are overrepresented in our dialysis population. Looking at the numbers that came out of China, 10% of dialysis patients ultimately became COVID positive and 20% of staff. CASER is the Kidney Community Emergency Response here in the USA, and a week ago the numbers were approximately 3,000 of the 500,000 individuals on dialysis in the country were COVID positive, with over 300 deaths and about 500 staff who'd been infected. Illinois is standing, as of a week ago, number five in the nation for number of outpatient dialysis who are COVID positive at 117. And here at Northwestern, we've got 12 patients on the floors who are COVID positive dialysis patients. The way to mitigate risks for these patients very early on, the outpatient dialysis units put in very strict screening procedures. The major dialysis companies have opened up 8 COVID positive units across the city for both PUI as well as for COVID positive patients. But you can imagine that transportation for COVID positive patients is not easy coming three times a week. So our hospital leadership has been fabulous in helping us get the dialysis organizations in touch with the Army Corps and the State Department of Health to try and think about alternative options if our hospitals become overwhelmed, and putting dialysis facilities in McCormick Place for otherwise stable patients. Kidney transplant patients, another very interesting aspect. I don't have time to talk about it today. I believe John Friedewald will give an update on this aspect later on. Just in the final two slides, we've had terrific support from a national organization, the American Society of Nephrology, who on an infrastructure already built with terrific collaborations with the FDA, CDC, HHS, and the White House, were able to rapidly put together a nationwide ASN COVID-19 response team. And they have been tremendously helpful in changing legislation for telehealth, removing mandatory in-person dialysis visits. They've rapidly developed in real time guidelines for practicing nephrologists, both outpatient, inpatient. And I think most importantly, they're advocating for our patients who really are vulnerable. And to give you an example, Michigan put a blanket policy out that all dialysis patients who become COVID-19 were not going to be eligible for intubation. So they're working very hard to fight this very unfair policy, and also to ensure that our patients do get enrolled in these very important trials, such as the vaccine trials, as we go forward, as kidney patients are often excluded. So I'm going to finish there. I don't have time to thank all the incredible individuals across the organization. All I can say is it is really a proud moment to be part of this incredible organization during this crisis situation. And I have to give a big shout out to our everyday heroes who are saving lives all every day in the hospital, but who have become superheroes during this pandemic. So thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for allowing me to present. And thank you to the other presenters. Next slide, I have no disclosures. Next slide. So here is an outline of what we're going to be discussing today. And really the first is focusing on practical approaches to patients with known cardiovascular disease or CVD. And then after that, we're going to get into some of the presentations of new CVD we're seeing in COVID, as well as potential mechanisms and approaches to therapy. Next slide. So we'll start with looking at COVID-19 in patients with known CVD. Next slide. The bulk of our early observational data are not surprisingly from Wuhan, where in this particular study, they compared case fatality rates among people with different pre-existing conditions. Now, as you can see, those with pre-existing CVD, diabetes and hypertension, as well as, of course, those with chronic respiratory disease and cancer had substantially higher case fatality rates. Next slide. Now, looking at illness severity in specific, we see similar patterns, and this is from a separate study of a separate Wuhan-based case series of patients with COVID pneumonia. Now, here, as you can see, they compared patients who required ICU care on the left to patients who didn't require ICU care. And again, not surprisingly, patients who required ICU care were older, and the proportions of patients with diabetes, hypertension, and CVD were several fold higher among patients who required ICU care. Now, looking a little bit lower, and Mike Cuttica discussed this to some extent as well, there were significant differences in markers of thrombosis and end organ damage. And this is actually between patients who required ICU care and those who didn't require ICU care. And there was a notable difference in elevated markers of cardiac injury, D-dimer, as well as just general myopathy. So the next question really is, what does this mean? What do these markers mean? In one report, there was a pretty strong association between of D-dimer and IL-6 with much higher mortality levels among people with COVID-19. And then go ahead to the next slide. Looking at cardiac injury as a prognostic marker, this is a separate study, another one from Wuhan, in which they evaluated 187 patients. Now, none of these patients had MIs on admission, but not surprisingly, are really the top line here and the bottom line here. In the top line, we see those who had known CVD and cardiac injury had the highest mortality, and those without CVD and without cardiac injury had the lowest. But what's interesting in this graph that I want to draw your attention to is there was a pretty clear difference whereby patients without known CVD who had cardiac injury during hospitalization, this is the second highest curve, had nearly threefold higher mortality than patients with known CVD who did not have cardiac injury. And that's the second lowest curve here. So given these and other emerging data, serial troponin measurement has become increasingly common clinical practice among sicker COVID patients as a way to better risk stratify and understand on an ongoing basis potential additional prognostic markers. So next slide, this is looking at practical considerations related to ACE and ARB therapy. So really, this has been an area of interest since an early report in Lancet questioning the use of these RAS blockers. And as Dr. Quaggin and many others have discussed, ACE2 seems to be a key player here. So we know ACE2 is widely expressed in the heart, in kidneys, and other tissues. And of course, this includes lung alveolar epithelial cells, where SARS-CoV-2 binds to ACE2 to enter host cells. Now, this might imply that blocking ACE2 receptors would be desirable in COVID-19, but we really don't know. And in fact, the opposite is true as well. And a lot of this is because ACE2 otherwise has beneficial and really counter-regulatory effects in that ACE2 degrades angiotensin II and therefore reduces angiotensin II's more vasoconstrictive, pro-inflammatory, and ultimately potentially pro-fibrotic effects. So theoretically, it could be bad to block ACE2, it could be good, we really just don't know. Next slide. And the next question is, of course, what does this mean for ACE inhibitor and ARB therapy? And really, given the conflicting theory and data, again, we don't know, we certainly can't recommend stopping therapy. And as really anyone who's rotated in an ICU probably can remember, And as I remember from just about every NICU attending I've ever had, a dry lung is a happy lung. So I can't imagine a world in which exacerbating known heart failure or potentially worsening hypertension for someone at risk for heart failure is going to help this overall situation. Next slide, and this is really an evolving area, practical considerations regarding QT prolonging meds. A few days ago, there was an advisory that came out of Circulation, and then just yesterday, there was a preprint publication about a premature discontinuation of a non-randomized study on chloroquine due to concerns of arrhythmia. And so the bottom line is hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin individually can cause QT prolongation. So monitoring QT at the minimum, and then either considering stopping or at least talking to a cardiologist once the QTC starts to get around 500 or even higher is really the best interim advice we can give. Next slide. So next we're going to talk about CVD pathogenesis in COVID-19, a lot of which is based on cases and some of which is based on really mechanistic extrapolations. So the bar is still fairly low, unfortunately, for evidence here. Next slide. So first I want to talk about a few key points. Certainly, most of the myocardial injury we see here is likely demand ischemia in the setting of critical illness. And despite being a cardiologist, I will freely admit that COVID-19 really seems to be primarily a respiratory disease. Yet, we still are seeing some cases of atherothrombotic events, like type 1 MIs, as well as myocarditis. And all of this may not be driven merely by the virus, but also by profound immune activation, perhaps macrophage activation, and inflammation in response to the virus. So given this, we may be able to learn something from other infectious and inflammatory conditions. And this is really what I spend a good portion of my time studying. Next slide. So in thinking about inflammation and CVD in general, I think it's important to keep in mind this is not a simple or linear process, and it's really helpful to have a framework for this. So one thing I like to do is think about the who, what, where, when, and why of inflammation. So who is really the host, including their susceptibilities and their comorbidities. What and how is really the underlying immune landscape and the potential effectors driving inflammatory activation and resolution. Where is the tissue level and or systemic manifestations of the inflammation? When reflects different immune responses occurring at different times following exposure to the trigger? And then, of course, why is the underlying triggers? And these can be infectious, as in the setting of HIV or perhaps COVID, or non-infectious, as we see, for instance, with apolipoprotein B within the arterial plaque. Next slide. So now to briefly review the epidemiology, we know that the risk for acute coronary syndromes increases in the setting of acute respiratory infections, including influenza, and it also increases in several different infectious and chronic inflammatory conditions. Several of these conditions are also marked by an elevated risk of heart failure. So this figure on the right is taken from a recent paper led by Samir Prasada, who's an excellent resident here. And we found that several different inflammatory conditions, across many of these conditions, there was a graded association whereby higher levels of inflammation were clearly associated with higher risk for heart failure. Next slide. So what are the mechanisms at play here? Now, first, let's think about atherothrombosis, which underlies MI risk. This is a slide from a recent review by Peter Libley, and of course, time is not going to allow me to dive into this deeply, but the bottom line here is that in the setting of systemic infections, pathogen and damage-associated molecular patterns, activated leukocytes, and really potentially dramatic cytokine release all can drive inflammation and thrombosis, therefore triggering MI. Next slide. So what about direct myocardial inflammation and injury and direct myocardial damage from the virus and immune response? Now, we know from animal models that several key immune responses are involved in adverse cardiac responses to both infectious and non-infectious triggers. And this includes replacement of cardiac resident macrophages with more pro-inflammatory monocyte-derived macrophages, also potentially T-cell autoreactivity against cardiac myosin. Now, this has relevance in several known conditions, but is also likely relevant or perhaps relevant in COVID-19 as well, in which we're beginning to see some cases of myocarditis, both in case reports and here at Northwestern. Next slide. So finally, taking this all together, here's a conceptual model on cardiac injury in COVID-19 that a talented fellow I work with, Arjun Sinha, put together. Now, I don't really have time to discuss this in detail, but the key point here is to highlight there are several potential mechanisms in play, ranging from demand ischemia to direct viral injury, perhaps, although we still don't completely know whether whether SARS-CoV-2 is directly infecting the myocardium. But there's also a likely significant role of maladaptive immune responses. These mechanisms play out over different time horizons, and this makes determining which therapies to give and when quite difficult, of course. But of course, all of this is worth considering as we start to think of these issues. Next slide, and not surprisingly, here I just highlight this is really a data sparse zone, especially for COVID myocarditis. And it seems that there may be a role for antiviral therapy, there may be a role for immunomodulatory therapy and or convalescent plasma. But at this point, we really don't know. And we really are doing individualized empiric therapy to figure out the best timing of therapy and specific targets for it. Next slide. So I'd like to acknowledge lab personnel, Northwestern collaborators and mentors, my external collaborators, of course, everyone on the front lines, which, you know, in cardiology, we're all trying to do our best to support how we can, but undeniably, the critical care docs, the pulmonologists, the internists, the anesthesiologists, the ER docs, and the non-physician staff all involved on the front line are really doing the yeoman's work here. So I'll leave it next slide with just the key points here for you on the screen, and to thank you, and this is how you can reach me. I'm admittedly a novice on Twitter, so I barely put that up, but thanks very much.
Great, good morning. So I'll be brief and I'll give an update on community pandemic projections. Right, I just have one disclosure to make. So for the past few weeks, a group of us here at Northwestern has been working on developing prediction models for community spread of COVID-19. There's actually been three groups. So our group, group at University of Chicago, a group at University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. And our model actually has been looking at a compartmental model. It's a little bit more complicated than a typical sort of SEIR model, one that uses sort of symptomatic or susceptible patients, exposed, infected, or recovered patients. But the thing to recognize about all prediction models is that they're generally wrong. The reality is most times you're wrong more often than you are correct, but it's oftentimes in combination with other models can give you some sense of directionality of where things might be going. And so working with Jolene Girardin and others here, we've been trying to put together these models and gather a lot of these different components, these compartments, oftentimes from early literature. And where we can, we supplement it with local data. So because we're working with the governor's office and IDPH closely, we and those models haven't been finalized. I can't give you the final models, but those will probably come out, I think, maybe later this week. But what we do have is models we can show you for local. So at NMH, looking at different types of non-pharmaceutical interventions, we can model out what the effect of those might be and what that might mean for projections of COVID positive cases, and in particular where we might peak. And this is really important during the upswing when you're thinking about resource allocation, but it's going to be equally important, maybe more so, when we start thinking about how do we intelligently reopen parts of society. And that, I think, consideration is becoming more and more of a concern as we recognize how much of an impact this is having on society. And so as you can see from this model, on that sort of red line, that's where we expect that stronger social distancing is having a pretty significant effect. And so we think stronger correlates with roughly 80% or higher of reduction in people's sort of activities, a weaker being somewhere below that. And as you can see, if you have stronger social distancing, we expect that we will be able to mitigate the rise of cases and be able to manage that from a capacity standpoint. And that seems to be the case, not just for NMH, but also for many of the other systems that we're looking at across Illinois. So as everyone's seen, we obviously still have rising COVID cases. This is the Illinois cases through, I think, just Sunday of this week. And as you look at this curve, you think, well, it's still going up and up. How is our sort of intervention and shelter in place having an effect? When you change the curve to be logarithmic, what you can see is that, in fact, we had this sort of a logarithmic rise up to a certain point. Shelter in place was put in place as of March 21st. As you can see, this is where you start seeing that flattening of the curve. And so since that shelter in place was put in place, and I think I would commend our governor for having stepped in early and putting this in place, and our mayor for being just a meme wizard and really hammering on this, they've really found a way to actually really enforce this. And as you can see, it's had really a dramatic effect, and it was really impressive that they did it very early on. Over on the bottom right, you can see the doubling times have dramatically reduced. And so we went from one of the first weeks when the cases were rising, doubling times were happening every 1.8 days. In this last week, it's been every 7.9 days. And so you can see this has really had quite a dramatic effect. And we hope that, again, the conversation will then hopefully transition to how then do we sort of intelligently sort of reopen parts of society. So the other key part of this is when you do prediction is to help identify how you might actually use resources. I would argue that COVID-19 does not respect institutional boundaries, and we are all in this together. And so I think it's really important to try to understand not only where we are in terms of resource allocation, in fact, we're doing quite well, but rather how are we doing sort of as a region? And these data, I'm not gonna say they're completely accurate because one thing we've recognized in tracking this condition is that resources are constantly changing. So new capacities coming online, for example, at Northwestern, we constantly have sort of, we're tracking these numbers and opening up new beds and new units as we need to. And so what we have found though is that in general, and I'll show you the slide for the region or the city. Let me see if this works, yeah. So what we're seeing actually is going along with the flattening of the curve is that we're seeing a general sort of consistency in bed utilization. And so although there's been generally a slight rise in the number of beds used, ICU beds, we are seeing that ventilator capacity and the ventilator beds being used has been holding steady for the past week, somewhere ranging from the 49% to 56% range in terms of total ventilator beds used. Now, that's in large part because of good planning from institutions like Northwestern and the region. So we have actually expanded a lot of ventilator capacity. And as a result, even though the cases are rising sort of gradually, the ventilator capacity is also rising along with that. And so again, we're hopeful that this will continue to stay steady in this range of, you know, sort of well below what we need in total. I'm gonna reflect on some of the things I heard earlier today. We didn't sort of coordinate this, but independent of Sue mentioning this, one thing that we've recognized is that to date, we've mostly been tracking total hospital beds, ICU capacity, and ventilator beds. But actually, there's been early signals that dialysis beds are becoming a real resource constraint. And so some of our colleagues at other hospitals have been mentioning this. And I think there's, I think, a strong sort of consideration now for us to start tracking dialysis beds, because again, it's sort of a regional response that matters. The other thing to keep in mind is although the curve is flattening, I think we have to be very concerned about other hotbeds in the community. So long-term care facilities are really a high sort of volume sort of place. In fact, over 200 long-term care facilities out of 1,200 in Illinois actually have positive COVID cases. And the mortality rate in those populations is very high, 20-30%. And so those are potential sort of sources for cases that we will then subsequently see. The jail is also a very large source, and the community living centers, for example, places like homeless shelters, we're seeing a lot of cases there. So although the curve is flattened, I'd caution that we may see continued spikes coming in from certain hot spots within the community that we're not currently watching. I will just also just close by noting that in addition to prediction and sort of real-time intelligence. There's been a lot of effort going on to try to develop intelligence and build data sets that will allow us to actually study the course of this condition. And folks here, for example, in Chicago, Bill Trickett County, Dan Schneider here at Northwestern, have been leading development of sort of a common data model or common platform by which we might track clinical cases of COVID. And then nationally, we've also seen that there's been work across a consortia like PCORnet developing a large common data model to track the same sort of clinical outcomes for 80 to 100 million individuals. And then locally, I just point out that we have a coalition of investigators that we've pulled together for the past few weeks. There's the website and there's the web link in case folks are interested. We are welcoming all volunteers with any data sort of savviness to help us in these builds. So I'll stop there and thank you. To particularly thank several folks, Jolene, Kevin, who's done a lot of work on developing this dashboard, which as of this week are now being used by IDPH, and then a number of other investigators, and particularly our colleagues at Chicago Department of Public Health, Illinois Department of Public Health as well. So thank you.